Amen. Make sure you share on Facebook.
The last
share.
One, I wanted to explain it before we sing. And Corey will tell you, I waited to the last minute to even share the song because a part of me was kind of embarrassed. It's kind of ashamed to tell the truth, but I didn't want to come tonight and ask you to do something that I love. And so God was really dealing with me about just the things that I say, the things that I think that are unlike him, self-deprecating thoughts. You know, you say something, that ain't gonna work. Man, I'm not the one. I'm not that person. And people who know me know that's something that I say really often. And God revealed to me that as I was saying it, I was literally writing that word on my heart. And so I was writing on my heart, I'm not the one. Don't use me. Not this Jew. Somebody else. There's people more saved. And all of those words being written on my heart. And nobody could see it. I wasn't like wearing it like on a shirt, but it was written on my heart. And so God said tonight for his people that he wants to write something new over your heart. That he wants to write what he says about you over your heart. Yes. And I don't know about you, but I can't just do it one day. I have to wake up the next day and repeat again what God says about me.
Yes.
If I get to about 8 a.m. or 9 a.m., I'll just start saying what I think about myself. And it may not line up with what God thinks about me. So every day we have to ask him that. Write it on my heart again. Say it to me again. And then repeat what he says about us. And it's like a journal. We keep a journal and we write the pages. And every day we have an opportunity to write a new page. So tonight I want to share with you my journal. And then when it comes to the chorus, it's what God wrote over my heart. And it's not pretty. And it's not, oh God, you're wonderful and you're awesome. It's some ugly things that I said about myself. And even if there's just one person in the room that said the same thing, this song is for you. Because God wants to write on you. God wants to rename you. God wants to reword the things that you said about yourself. Yes, and today he's going to give you a new page on your journal.
Yes.
And I thank God that his ink lasts longer than my words. So I may say something, but when he writes it, he stamps it. It's sealed.
Yes.
So
yes.
Tonight, God is going to seal some things on our heart.
Seal some things on our heart.
All right, can we stand in agreement, God? I want you to seal some things on our heart.
Seal some things on our heart. Seal some things on our heart today.
Not for a recording's sake.
Send some
things. For the fact that when we leave here, we got to go back out in a world that's going to say some things about us and ask us to say some things about ourselves that have nothing to do with him. So let's guard our hearts against that tonight.
Hallelujah.
So I'm going to share my journal with you, and then we're going to ask God to just write new words upon our heart.
We're going to go to 1 Kings, the 17th chapter.
Not worth it. It's too late to start again. And I'm sure I'm useless in the hands of the Creator. I'm not enough to salvage, and I'm not enough to build with, so don't try. No, I won't try. But then came your word, healing, affirming word, riding on my heart, riding on my mind. So I'll never forget it. Your word, healing, affirming word, riding on my heart, riding on my mind. So I'll never forget it, your word. Walking around fearful, what if someone finds out the truth that I'm shattered, pieced together by the love of you, not worthy of your attention. I'm so guilty and ashamed. Please don't use me. No, you can't use me. But here comes your word.
And yet you love me so deeply.
Hallelujah. Amen. Your
worship, man, I just ask that you get to that
amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Good morning, Revelation and friends. Good morning, everyone. We are here, and we thank God for every one of you all for being on today. We're going to prepare to have Evangelist Beard lead us in prayer. And at the end of the service, we want you to stick around because we are going to have Deacon Beard give us one of those old-time hymns. Amen. So we are going to call forth Evangelist Beard or Deacon Beard, either one of them, to lead us in a word of prayer. Amen.
Father, once again, we come this morning, Jesus, just to say thank you, Master. Heavenly Father, we thank you for our laying down last night and our early rising this morning. Father, as I rose and looked around, the family chain had not been broken. Father, I just want to say thank you this morning, Master.
Yes.
Heavenly Father, I thank you for this service we have in this morning. Heavenly Father, we are not all in one place, but we can communicate with one another.
Yes.
Father, I want to thank you for it this morning.
Yes.
Heavenly Father, now the word go forth, Master, I pray that you will give us an ear to hear what your word has to say. Most of all, Master, let us be obedient to your word.
Yes.
This I'm asking in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Deacon Beard. We're going to have our announcements. Pastor.
Announcements as following. First, we'd like to thank everyone for being on today with us. Weekly announcements. Every morning from 9 to 10, we have Sunday school, which we are studying Christian discipleship. From 11 to 12, we have morning service. Every Tuesday from 6 to 7, we have Bible study. These are taking place on Zoom and Facebook, Revelation Baptist Church. And 2 hours to 3 hours after each service, Pastor will put it on YouTube. And during the week, Pastor's putting messages and thoughts on YouTube so that we can get a YouTube or Facebook or one of them, he put it on so you can get the message. Just check them out. Check them all out. Our prayer list, we're praying for everyone. Our hearts goes out to everyone. We have a special prayer request for Sister Renee Wade, family and friends, and the loss of their grandmother. But let us pray for everybody, whether we know your name or you know them. Our hearts are going, prayers are going out to them. Let's continue to pray one for another.
Amen.
You can continue your communion as you see fit. If you like to give, you can give to the cash out. And it's a $ Revelation Baptist Church. And if you don't want to do that, you can always contact Sister Watson, Mother Elizabeth Hayden, or myself, Assistant Dottie Beard, and we'll help you out in making whatever you decide to do. Our scripture today will be, "Behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me?" And that's Jeremiah 32 and 27. Now I'll turn you back to the hands of our pastor, Pastor Marcus Beard.
Amen. Is there anything too hard for our God? Amen. Somebody should just say that right now. There's nothing too hard for my God. I want to thank Pastor Beard and Deacon Beard for that. I do want to clarify, the Cash App is not Revelation Baptist Church. It is Revelation Church, Revelation Church, without the Baptist on it. So that is our Cash App, and we thank you all for your contributions, and we are praying for each and every one of you all. Amen. Amen. So I am excited about the Word of God. Amen. And we are going to get into it. I think I did a typo. It is coming from 1 Kings, the 17th chapter, First King, the 17th chapter. I'm going to play one quick song, amen, and I want us to prepare our minds. But if you make sure that you are texting, sharing, amen, inviting people to come and hear this word. And the word today is, I am essential. I am essential. So I want you to reach out to those people who are feeling down and feeling devalued, that need some encouragement from the word of God, and let them know that they need to get on, amen, and turn to 1 Kings, the 17th chapter, so then we can get into that after this song. God bless you all.
When you prophesy to your neighbor, tell them God's already moving on your behalf. Your single song just says, "Tomorrow's ready, yeah, he's better. Tomorrow's ready, yeah, he's easier. God's already moving on your behalf." It's already getting better. It's already getting easier. It's already moving on my way. Everybody say, it's already getting better. It's already getting easier. It's already moving on.
Already working it out for me. Amen. Amen. I want you to know today that it is getting better. I don't care how tough life has been. I don't care how challenging things have become in your life. I don't care what has arisen in your life. I declare to you that it's already getting better. Amen. And if you believe that, just give God a radical praise right where you are by yourself. Amen. Just say hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Because the devil don't want you to give him praise this morning. Amen. The devil wants you to sit there and just watch and be so concerned about what's going to happen on next week and what's going to happen on next month. Amen. And what's going to happen tomorrow. Amen. But I dare somebody to make the devil out into a liar and just begin to give God some praise for where you at. Amen. And say, God knows where I'm at. Amen. God's got me and it's getting better. Amen. And he is going to work this thing out for me. Amen. I believe that today. I'm excited to have you all here today. I am excited because I want you to know that you are essential. It is important, amen, that you understand how essential you are. You are so essential that the devil has been trying to shut you up and shut you down, amen. Even on this week, the devil has been trying to shut you up and shut you down, amen, because he knows that you are essential, amen. So today I want you to declare, I'm not letting any technical difficulties, amen. I'm not letting any interruptions, amen. I am turning my phone on do not disturb so I don't get no text messages, no phone calls, or nothing, because I need to hear this word of God, amen, so that I can go out and be the essential worker that he has called me to be during this time. Amen. So today I want you to be prepared. I'm glad that you joined us. I'm glad that you got others to join. And I want you to be prepared for this word, because in order for us to operate in our kingdom responsibilities, we have to understand how valuable we are. Amen. Amen. So I'm not coming to beat you up and badger you and drag you down and condemn you. My job today is to build you up in the word of God, amen, and to inspire and motivate you, amen, to empower you and to increase your faith in God, amen, through the word of God on today, because you are more valuable than you think, amen. So we're going to come from the first Kings, the 17th chapter, the 17th chapter. Those of you who are in California, some of the other states, you all had a little few week stay at home. You call it quarantine, lockdown, amen. But in California, we've been doing this for about almost 2 months now, amen. And it is still going, and we are living at a time where so many people are losing their job, or they're furloughed, or they are working from home, amen. And only essential businesses are open, and there's so much debate on what is essential, amen. And I just want to say this, that the work of that the Lord has called us to was never a church work. So there are so many people that are upset and uncomfortable, and they have the standpoint that the church house, the church building, is essential, And there's definitely a work that we have as the church, amen, of the fellowship. But what is really essential is not so much the opening doors of a church building, but it's really opening the minds and the hearts of those of us who follow Christ, who go to church, amen. So while the church doors are not open, it is actually providing a greater opportunity for us as essential workers, as disciples of Christ. That's what we are, essential workers, to go out and get the work done. Amen. It is time for us to not wait for a door to be opened, but for us as the kingdom of God
to go and do those things that God has called us to do, and He will open the doors for us to do that. So when I talk about being essential, I am not talking about a church building. When I'm talking today about being essential, I am talking about those of us who are disciples of Christ, who are workers of Christ, who are following out of His commission to go out and tell the world, amen, about Him, amen. So when I look at this text, we are looking at the prophet Elijah, and this is his appearance on the scene in 17 chapter 1 of 1 Kings, the 17th chapter, verses 1, it says, and Elijah the Tishbite of the inhabitants of Gilead said to Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel lives before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years except at my word. I want you to look at yourself in a mirror or just speak to yourself, and I want you to say these words, I am essential. I am essential. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for this opportunity that we have to virtually get together and really dig into your word, Father God. I pray, Father God, that you would speak life into everyone who hears your word, Father God, and that you would spark an excitement and a motivation for us to even seek your word further, Father God, that this word today will empower someone to get on the field and get in the game and do what you have called us to do, Father God, that you will lift up a heavy burden head, Father God, that you would touch and encourage a heart, Father God, that's about to give up, Father God, that you would speak life to someone who's on the verge of just throwing in the towel, that today you will speak value to them, that you will speak purpose to them, that you will speak destiny to them, that you would wake them up from their sleeping spot, that you will wake them up from complacency, that you would wake them up from confusion, that you will wake them up from feeling like that they're not enough, Father God, and that you will show them their value to you and that their contribution to your kingdom assignment, Father God, and that will revive them in the name of Jesus. I thank you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. You are essential. You are essential. You are important. The word essential actually means absolutely necessary, extremely important. Absolutely necessary, extremely important. And as Christians, once we really find our purpose, once we really start walking in what God has called us to walk in, once we really start doing what God has called us to do, we must understand that when we are doing what God has called us to do, we are absolutely necessary. We are extremely important. Amen. And in the body of Christ, I want you to know that if you are a believer of Jesus Christ, that you are absolutely necessary and you are extremely important. Before we go any further, I need you to understand that your past did not devalue you, but your past valued you and made you absolutely necessary and extremely important. That God looked beyond where you've been, amen, and He sees where you're going, and He wants you to understand that you are extremely important. Do not let anyone devalue you. Amen. Do not let anyone talk down about you. Amen. Do not let anyone make fun of you. Amen. Those things should not motivate you. Those things should not control your mind. You got to be able to look in the mirror and say that I've been abused. Amen. I've been beat up. I've been in some bad relationships. I made some bad mistakes. I made some terrible mistakes. I've fallen and rolled up in the thing that I fell in, but I am essential. I am important, because if I was not essential, if I were not important, then God would not have me here. Amen. He saved me because I am valuable to the kingdom. So you need to lift up your head, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and allow the King of glory, even right now in your home, to come in and let you know that, that he is the King of glory. He is the Lord who is strong and mighty, the Lord who is mighty in battle. Somebody needs to lift up their head today and say, I lost some things. Come on. There's some people who died in my life. Come on. There's some people who walked out on me. Come on, there's some relationships that didn't work out. Amen. There's some places and some things that I put my trust in, and my heart is broken right now. But I come to tell you this morning that you logged on so I can tell you that you are essential. It is important that you get up. It is important that you lift your head up, because there is something that God has for you to do for his kingdom. Amen. And you are essential. You are not too bruised to be essential. You are not too battered to be important. You are essential. I know, come on, I know the beauty supply ain't open and your hair is messed up. Come on, come on. You ain't got the eyelashes that you normally have, but I want you to understand that your essentialness was never about how you look. Come on, you can't make up being essential and important. Come on, you can look rough and messed up and still do the work of God. Come on, come on. You may not look like you got it going on, but you need to say, I got it going on. Come on, I am essential. Amen. I am important, and I will not lay down, and I will not let this season devalue who I am. Amen. In fact, in this season, folks are going to see my value. Come on. In this season, folks are going to see how anointed I am. In this season, folks are going to see how the power of God rests in my life. In this season, folks are going to see the peace of God that leads and guides me. People are going to see the work of God, the power of God in my life, because I am essential. I still got a work to do, even on a lockdown, even on a quarantine, even if I got to be indoors. I got a work to do. I am essential. I am important. And I come to tell the devil that your lies that you have been speaking to God's children, telling them that they are not important. Amen. Telling them that they are too bad and they make too many mistakes to be used by God. I come and I tell you, according to God's word, that these people are God's children and they are essential. They were fearfully and wonderfully made. Amen. Their sins have been forgiven. They have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, and therefore they are important. Somebody say, I am essential. I am essential today. I'm valuable. I'm important. I'm important. The Bible says in Mark 16 and 15, it says, and he said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Amen. So your essential duty is to preach the gospel to every creature. Amen. Amen. Some of you just need to start preaching it to the people that's in your home. Amen. They need to hear you stop complaining, stop yelling, stop fighting, come on, stop all arguing, stop being evil, and they need to see how essential you are. You can change the world by changing your home. Come on, you can change your community by changing the people in your home. You need to start acting like you are essential and get about the Father's business, which is to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. You are absolutely essential. Amen. The word of God, amen, is in you, amen, for you to go and share with somebody else. So the Bible talks about Elijah here in the 17th chapter of 1 Kings, verse 1. It says, and Elijah the Tishbite, amen. And Elijah means Yahweh is my God, right? Is my God. And it says that he went into Ahab. And he says, as the Lord God of Israel lives, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, except at my word. Now, if you are essential, there's something that you need to understand. You need to understand the power of what you say. You need to understand, Proverbs 18 and 21 says, life and death are in the power of the tongue. Get this, but it says, and those who love it will eat of its fruit. Come on, come on. Let me say it again. Life and death are in the power of the tongue. What I say produces life and death. And if I love it, amen, then I will eat, right? I will eat of its fruit, that my words will present things for me to eat off of. Amen. It will present situations for me to be successful, that I will prosper off of what I say. And that is why it is important that you do not involve yourself in unnecessary conversation. You know, anybody knows me know that I can sit and I can sit in a car with a car full of people and not say nothing. And most of the time I enjoy silence. Now some of you just ramble and you just got something to say all the time, and you just feel like if you're in the proximity of someone else, then you just make up stuff to say because you just don't, you're not happy with silence. But the Bible even tells us that when we speak a lot of words, sin is going to be present. So we have to guard what we say, and we have to make sure that everything that we say has life. Everything that we say is important. Everything that you want to say don't need to be said. Everything that you feel like saying don't need to be said. But we need to be in a position where we are speaking those things that the Lord is saying, amen, that we are not just having unnecessary conversation. Amen. Somebody need to really get that. Come on. Somebody need to get over their feelings right now. And you need to get that. You say, I need to practice being quiet. I need to practice shutting my mouth. I need to practice just hearing from God, because I can't be talking all the time and hearing from God at the same time. Amen. So I need to be able to hear from God, because if I am essential, there are some things that God would have me to say, that he has a sign for me to say, and I need to say it. Somebody say, I need to say it. Amen. Not what you feel, not what you think. Amen. But you need to be in a position where you are hearing from God so that you can speak what God has said. Amen. And you need to have the courage to speak, amen, to things that seem like they are authoritative or they have authority, amen. You need to be able to speak power to authority, amen. You need to speak God's word to authority. The Bible says that the Lord told Elijah the Tishbite to go to Ahab, and he said to Ahab, he says, by the God, the Lord God of Israel lives, whom I stand. He said, I'm standing on God's word. He says, get this, there shall not be dew nor rain these years except at my word. So he said, I'm standing in the authority of God. My God, I want you to understand there's something about authority. When you have authority, come on. Now authority and power are two different things, because you can have power but not have authority. Ahab had power, but Elijah had the authority of God. And he said that at the authority of God, get this, he says that there will not be rain for these years except at my word. He says that the sky is going to shut up. There's not going to be any rain until I say that it's going to rain. Not until God says it's going to rain. He says that God has put authority in my mouth, and there shall not be rain until I say so. It's important that you understand how essential, that if you are an essential worker, how important what you say. Amen. And there are some times that there's some things right now that's going on in your life that you need to speak life to. Come on. That you need to speak to. And you've been saying all these things against it. Amen. Oh, I'm broke. Come on. Oh, my body hurt. Oh, the doctor said this. And God is saying life and death is in the power. You need to change what you speak. You need to speak in the authority that God has given you. That child is not a crackhead. Come on. That child is not a prostitute. Come on. You need to speak in the authority. And when you have authority, you can call those things that be not as though they are. Come on, somebody. You can start speaking over that child, and the behaviors that they are exhibiting today, amen, you can speak against those things and call the child out. Call them holy. Call them righteous. Call them saved. Call them filled with the Holy Ghost. Call them anointed. Call them the man and the woman of God that they are, amen, not the actions and the deeds that they are doing. And I guarantee you that something is going to happen. Something is going to switch. Something is going to change. And one day they're going to wake up and be who you have called them to be. You need to see them the way that God sees them. You need to see yourself the way that God sees you. You need to understand that in spite of your past, you are still essential. So get this. So he says that there should not be dew or rain except at my word. He says that at my word, because I understand that God has given me authority. Amen. He has given me power. At my word, the rain will come. Now, you need to understand that this is important, because the prophet is now entering the scene, and the Canaanites actually believed that Baal controlled the rain. So by Elijah declaring that God had power, that his God had power over the power of Baal, over their God, it was caused to put him to death, right? So God speaks in verse 2 and says this. It says, then the word of the Lord came to him saying, get away from here and turn eastward and hide by the brook Cherith, which flows into the Jordan. And it will be that you shall drink from the brook, and I have commanded the ravens, right? This unclean bird, the ravens to come and feed you there. Verse 5. So he went, Elijah went, right? And did according to the word of the Lord. For he went and stayed by the brook, which flows into the Jordan. And the ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning, and the bread and meat in the evening. And he drank from the brook. This is important. So he stands on the authority of God. He speaks the word of God. He speaks truth to power. Amen. And the word of God is truth. Amen. He speaks truth to the power, because he has the authority of God, right? And the Lord tells him, now that you have spoken what I have told you to speak to him, I want you to go away. Now your life is in danger, and I have prepared ravens at this brook to take care of you. You're going to drink water at this brook, and the ravens are going to come and feed you. And so it's important that when you are essential, that you understand where God is leading you, that you hear the voice of God. Amen. That you are listening to what God is saying. You have to be able to listen to direction. And I understand some of you all have a problem listening and following directions. One thing about me and in my career, when working in logistics and management, one thing that I do is I invest a lot of time and energy in training people. So I invest a lot of time and energy in training my team so that they can do the job. One of the most annoying things for me, and the things that really take me there, is when I am trying to train someone in something and they ain't listening. They are not listening. They either think that they got it, or they want me to just spoon feed them through everything and walk them through everything every day. When you are a leader, what you want to do as a leader is empower your team to be able to do what they need to do without you walking them through step by step each time. Amen. And it is frustrating to me in any kind of situation, whether it's church, work, or anything, where I am trying to train someone on something and they just don't want to get it because they don't listen. Amen. And if you are an essential worker, you have to learn how to listen and follow directions. Get this. And the directions may go against how you feel and what you think, But you got to understand that the person who is giving you that direction, either you're going to trust them or you go trust in yourself. And it's important for me to understand, for you to understand this, because some of you are in a whirlwind or in a bad situation and all hell is breaking loose. You have no peace, you have no joy, and you have nothing going on but a lot of doom and destruction. And it's not because God is mad at you. It's because you fail to follow the directions. You want God to come into your plan, and God is saying, I don't want to come into your will. I want your will to be my will. Come on. I don't want to come and adhere to your decisions. I want your decisions to be based off of my decisions. You need to tell yourself, say, I'm going to follow directions. I just need to follow directions. Now get this. I can tell you how practical it is with following directions. Have you ever purchased an item, and a lot of items don't come with them anymore, but have you ever purchased, I remember when Keisha and I first got married, we went to IKEA, I think it was IKEA, and bought a bookshelf, and versus opening up and following the directions, I got to a place where I just felt like I can do it on my own. So when I completed the project, that bookshelf, or it could have been a TV case or whatever, it was slightly leaning to the side and weaker on one side because I didn't follow the directions. Amen. I went with how I thought it should be and how it looked it should be. Come on. Some of you all just like that. You look at the box and you see how it's supposed to look, and then you look at the tools that you have and you don't follow any kind of directions. You just start building. Amen. And some of you know that the mistakes that you make when you do not follow the direction. And what I like about this text with Elijah, the Bible says the word of the Lord came to him in verse number 2, and in verse number 5 it says, and so he went. Get this. In verse number 2, it says, the word of the Lord came to him. The word of the Lord came to him and said, get away from here, turn eastward, hide by the brook. You go drink some water by the brook. I'm going to send you ravens by the brook. And the Bible says in verse number 5, when God starts speaking, stopped speaking and told him what to do, that Elijah didn't argue with God and say, no, I want to go west, because west, there's more water there. The water's clean there. I got some folks over on west, the homies on the west side, so let me go over there, God. The Bible says, so he went and did according to the word of God, and he went and he stayed by the brook. Him going, and he held God to his word. Amen. And I come to tell someone that you just need to, at this season, hold God to his word. You need to go and do according to what the word of God says. Well, I don't know if the resources go be there. Go and do what he said. Well, I don't know if the ravens are going to be there. If God said the ravens are going to take care of you, then the ravens are going to take care of you. Come on. If God said that there's going to be water for you to drink at that brook, then there shall be water in that brook. Come on. If God said to step out and start your business, then you need to step out and start your business. Stop trying to collect ideas and thoughts and support for everyone else. Go out and do what God has called you to do, because you are essential. Come on. You don't need a fan club. Come on. You don't need a collective of folks that's encouraging you and pushing you forward. All you need to do is hear what God said, and you need to do what he told you to do. Elijah found himself being obedient to God, because if you're going to be an effective essential worker at this time, then you have to only go the places that God has told you to go. Come on. You have to be caught in the store when God called you to the store. Come on. Because if you're in the store when God called you to the store, then there's somebody in the store at that time that's going to need to hear the word that God has put on the inside of you to give them. Somebody say, give God some praise. Amen. Come on, say, I'm going to give God some praise. I'm going to give God some praise. Amen. And I'm going to do what he told me to do. Amen. What did God tell you to do? What has God spoken for you to do? I want you to understand that what God has called you to do, he has called you to do it because he knows who you are. Amen. Amen. So don't let the devil try to trick you and tell you that you're not worthy to be who God has called you to be. Because if you go where he told you to go, then you need to understand that he'll be there to take care of you. Amen. So it looked like Elijah was in a bad situation because he's sort of running for his life now. And God said, I'm going to take care of you. I got you. Amen. I come to tell you, I don't care what's against you. It could be finances. It could be sickness. Come on. It could be people. Amen. I don't care what is against you. Go where God has called you to go. Do what God has called you to do, and God will take care of you. So the Bible says that when he went, he says in verse 6, the ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning and bread and meat in the evening, and he drank from the brook. So he spoke the word of God. He spoke truth to power. Amen. And now God is instructing him and tells him to go to the brook. Amen. And the ravens will get there. Now something happens. Something happens when you are taking directions from God. Verse number 7 says, and it happened after a while that the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. Remember, he spoke to King Ahab and he said that there will not be any rain. So now, after a while, that brook, which depended on rainwater, amen, in order to keep the brook going, had dried up because what he has spoken to the prophet is now affecting the whole, to the king, the prophet has spoke to the king, is now affecting the whole land. So now the brook, the place where God told him to go and drink, has dried up, amen. And if the brook is dried up, now the ravens are not gonna come anymore. So now he has no food and he has no drink, but get this, he is in the place where God has told him to be. I wonder if somebody is in that place where you know 2 years ago God let you there. You know 5 years ago God let you there, but and you followed God to the place and he was sustaining you and he was taking care of you and you have fullness of joy and there was peace all around you. But now it seems like the place that you know that God placed you is full of hell. Now the place that you know that God has placed you, you're not prospering. And come in, the brook has dried up. What do you do when the brook dries up? Because get this, that there is a time and there is an expiration date for some of the provisions of God. Let me say that again. There's an expiration date for some of the provisions of God, and it is important that you don't get stuck in one place. Come on, I wish I had somebody that you don't get stuck. See, the problem is not that you got to that place because God led you to that place, but God led you to that place not for you to get complacent and not for you to stay permanently, but he led you to that place for you to hear the next word. Somebody say the next word, amen. God is calling you to step by step faith. God is calling us to step by step faith. Somebody say step by step faith. That means that he does not give us the map directions to everywhere that he wants us to go, but he will give us from one place to the next. He gave him, he said, go to the brook. But now that the brook has dried up, verse number 8 said, then the word of the Lord came to him saying, arise and go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. Get this. He says in verse 8 that then the word of the Lord came. And I had to think about this because sometimes we think that God protects us from the drought. Sometimes God will give us a word, amen, before the brook dried up. But the Bible tells us here that the brook dried up, and once the brook dried up, then the word of the Lord came. See, sometimes the conditions have to be bad for us to hear the word of God. Come on. And some of you should be praising God right there. That meant nothing for some of you all, but there's a few of you all that heard that and said that, oh yeah, my conditions are bad. My conditions are worse than they've ever been. I come to tell you that you are in a prime place to hear the next word from the Lord. Amen. Your next direction from the Lord. Now get this, you got to hear me clearly. You cannot be so clouded. You cannot be so focused on the dried up brook that you don't hear the voice of God. You got to let the dried up brook lead you to a place to have your ears attentive to God. What's next? Amen. God, what's next for me? Amen. I'm not going to hold on to what has been. I'm going to press forward to what's in the future for me. Lord, when the brook dries up, what's next? Amen. I don't want you to keep bringing water to a brook that you have designed to be dried up. Amen. I don't want to pray water to this brook. I want to hear your voice of what you have next for me. I wish somebody will make up in their mind that they're ready to go to the next thing. I'm ready to go to the next level. I'm ready to move to the next thing. Come on. I'm ready to move from another faith to another faith. Come on. I'm ready to trust God on a whole nother level. I'm ready to trust God with more. I've been faithful over a few things. I'm ready to be ruler over many. Is there anybody today that's ready for the next? Well, let's talk about the next. So it says, the word of the Lord says, go to Zarephath. And then the Lord said in verse 10, so he arose and he went. And when he came to the gate of the city, this is what the Lord said. He said, I'm going to have a widow there to provide for you. This is what he said in verse 10. But get this, when he gets to the gate, he sees the widow there, but the widow is gathering sticks. Wait. God said, go to Zarephath, and he said, dwell there, and he said, I have commanded a widow to provide for you. But when he gets there, he sees the widow. Thank you, God. Oh, I see the widow. But he looks at the widow, and he sees that the widow is gathering sticks. So, now he got told him that the ravens would provide for him at the brook. He went there. After a little while, the brook dried up. But God says, now go to Zarephath, and I have a widow woman who is going to provide for you. My God, my God. But when he gets there, he sees the widow, but he don't really see how she's going to provide, because it looks like she can't provide for herself. Somebody hears where I'm going. Let me tell you something, and this is what God told me to speak to somebody's life this morning. He says that God wants you to understand that he has put somebody in your path, my God, that he will use to perform his word for your life. Let me look at you and tell you that God has already provided in this season, right now, in your drought season, come on, in your season where you don't see where your provision is, come on, in your season where it seems like things have dried up, God wanted me to come and tell you that he has provided somebody somewhere, come on, right now, and that will perform his word in your life. Somebody that is in your path right now that will perform his provision, his word for your life. If you get to where God has called you to be, amen, if you get about the work of God, he will send people on your path. He has people prepared with everything that you need in order to perform his promises towards you. Somebody say, I thank you, God. I thank you that you're providing right now. Every need in my home is provided for. Come on. Every need that I have, you have provision for. And I am not seeking those things. I am not stressed out about stuff. I ain't stressed out about food, toilet paper, chicken, meat, beef, or anything else. I am trusting in the Lord, amen, because I know that you got somebody somewhere that is going to help me out on this journey. You have somebody somewhere that's authorized to do something that's going to work in my favor. Somebody say something's working in my favor. Folks are talking about you right now. Folks are putting in a good word for you right now. There are job opportunities that are opening for you right now. I wish I had some business opportunities opening for you right now. Blessings coming to your house right now. Folks are thinking about you right now. Why? Because God has you on their mind because you have God on your mind. Let me help somebody. I said, God has you on their mind because you have him on your mind. Somebody needs to stop right now and give God a praise right now because he's sending it your way. He's sending it your way. Come on. You've been waiting on your stimulus, but God said that I got some resources. Come on, that you have not tapped into yet. Come on, preacher, whoever you are right now, don't be discouraged because there's no offerings coming into your church. God said that I got people right now, come on, that is just ready for you to get your mind on God. Stop thinking about what you lost. Stop thinking about what you lack. God told me to tell you that he got people that got resources that are going to come your way. And if you get your mind on him, then he will send those resources your way. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and all of his righteousness and all these other things that will be added unto you. I know you got a light bill. Come on. I know you got a gas bill. I know you got a car note. I know your rent is due. I know your mortgage is due. I know your business insurance is due. But God said that I got some people with some resources, and all I'm waiting on is for you to put your mind on me. Stop worrying about all that other stuff and put your mind on me, and I will perform my word for you. Amen. Somebody thank God for that. So this woman didn't look like she was a provider. But what is important is that the person who God has authorized to help you on this journey, to perform his word for you, amen, to strengthen you, to encourage you, that person is not the resource. They are just the vessel. So it doesn't matter what they look like. It's about what God is going to do from the situation. So he gets to this gate of this town, and he sees the widow, and she is gathering sticks, and he calls her. This is still on verse number 10, and it says that he calls her, and he says to her, please bring me a little water in a cup that I may drink. And as she was going to get it, he called to her and said, please bring me a morsel of bread in your hand. She's gathering sticks. The prophet says, please go get me some water. Remember, the brook dried up. He's thirsty. He gets there. He says, please bring me some water. She has no problem being obedient to the man of God. The Bible says that she goes. She starts, and on her way to go. Now, get the picture. She is gathering twigs, and this man just comes to her. She is a widow. Her husband is dead, right? She is a widow. She's gathering twigs. This man comes that she does not know, but he says, give me some water. And there's something inside of her where she does not mind serving the man of God. And I just come to tell somebody that you need to learn how to stop thinking so much about yourself and start thinking about what God would have you do. Amen. And what God would have you do is think about others. Amen. Some of us are too selfish. Amen. I'm not putting myself in that. Some of y'all are too selfish. Amen. To see the miracle that God wants to do in your life, because you only see that you need twigs. You don't see that by doing the work of God, that God will put you in a place where you don't have to gather twigs no more. Who am I talking to? Somebody need to say, I'm tired of gathering twigs. Come on. I'm tired of just living off straps. I'm tired of begging. Come on. I'm tired of being the borrower. I'm tired of being the tail. I am the head. I'm ready to rise above all this. I'm tired of living paycheck to paycheck. Come on. I'm tired of depending on everybody else to do something for me. I'm tired of having to call everybody else to lift me up and to do something. I'm tired of gathering the twigs. Is there anybody this morning that's tired of just gathering the twigs? Come on. That's tired of just living on the edge. That's tired of just living in need. That's just tired of always needing somebody to encourage you. I'm tired of walking around picking up twigs. There has to be something more valuable in my life than picking up twigs. She found her value in service. She stopped thinking about herself and her condition. And she said, yes, I got problems. Yes, I got some things I need to work out. Yes, I don't have much. Yes, I'm about to end and my life is about to end, but if I can help somebody as I travel along the world, come on. So I come to tell somebody that you are just one moment away from your breakthrough. You got one person that you just need to help, and God is going to open up the windows from heaven for you. Come on, somebody. You got to stop being selfish and stop thinking about yourself. And even in your drought and even in your season of not having, if you can find a way to help somebody on this journey, amen, that could be the thing. That move could be the move that can change and redirect your whole life, amen. Just one person. You just one person, amen. One sacrifice, amen. You are one sacrifice away from your miracle. I don't know what your sacrifice is. Only you know what your sacrifice is. But I want you to understand, stop holding on to your sacrifice, because you're holding on to your sacrifice because you think that you need it. You think you need to gather the twigs, but you need to hear the word of God. And if God tells you to give the man of God, amen, some water, amen, then you need to drop your twigs and go in the direction of giving the water, amen. What are you holding on to? What are you focused on when you should be doing the work of God? Amen. This woman was at her last point, but she said that before I die, I'm going to do something for the man of God. Come on. Before I die, I'm going to do something for God's will. Amen. I'm going to do something to promote his purpose. Amen. And his plan and his kingdom. I'm going to do, what are you doing? Amen. What are you doing other than gathering twigs? So she went in the direction of getting the water, but then he says, please bring me a morsel of bread in your hand. Now the dilemma starts, because she says to him in verse 12, as the Lord your God lives, I do not have bread. I only have a handful of flour in a bin and a little oil in a jar. And I am here gathering a couple sticks that I may go in and prepare for myself and my son that we may eat and die. You are not ready to see the abundance of God until you are ready and willing to give up your last. Let that sit. You are not ready to see the abundance of God until you are willing to sacrifice and give up your last. Let's just talk about offering and tithing. Some of you are stressed out about finances because you robbed God. Let me say that again. Some of you all are stressed out and worried about finances, how are bills going to get paid, because you robbed God. What do you mean, Pastor? Some of you haven't paid tithes since the quarantine. Amen. Because you have built a stock in your home, and you're saying that I can't afford to give 10% because I got to make sure that I can take care of these bills while I'm not working. And what God is saying, that's fine. I'm not going to make you pay tithes. But what I will do is allow you to see that I will not open the windows of heaven and I will not pour you out a window of blessings unless you bring me into my storehouse. Come on, somebody in here. So I'll let you live your life worrying about finances because you should be giving me $50, but you choose to give me $5. Come on, who am I talking to in here? So you have thought that, oh, I'll just give a little, but he said that if you are not doing it, come on, somebody, fully by faith, step by step, faith by faith, faith by faith. He says that if you just give me fully what I requested from you, amen, I will work miracles in you. There are some people that don't have much, but they give the little that they have, and God is constantly providing for them. Some of you all are here right now watching. God is constantly providing for you because you don't have a lot, but you every penny that you get, you committed to giving him 10% of it. Amen. Amen. And that means that you may not get your tracks done, but guess what? The hair places ain't open anyway. Somebody say, come on, and you still hoarding God. And God is saying that you are going to worry about stuff because you have not given what's rightfully mine. But this woman was different. She says that all I have, and she said, what I'm doing is I'm preparing my last, and I have accepted the fact that this is my last meal. And guess this, I'm gathering twigs, I have this little bit of oil, I have this little bit of flour, a morsel of flour, and I'm about to make me and my son this bomb meal because we are going to eat, and this is going to be, it's only a little, but I'm going to make a lot out of a little. And I don't know about you, but I know some women who know how to make a little, turn a little into a lot. Come on, somebody. I remember times as a kid growing up, and I would see my parents and my mama specifically be able to turn a little bit into a whole lot. Amen. Don't have much food, but all of us ate. Amen. And was able to give some to the neighbors because there's something about a mother when she wants to provide for her child. Amen. She will take the little bit that she has and she will make that thing into something. Come on. It could be the last meal. Amen. She said, this is my last meal, but I'm going to make sure that I'm not going to throw in the towel. I'm going to feed my baby. And I want you to understand that God is just like that. God will take a little bit that you have. And if you put it in his hands, if you trust in the Lord with all your heart, he will take that little and he will make much out of it. Who am I talking to today? God, your little that's left, God wants you to understand that he will make that little a lot. Somebody say, he's going to make my little a lot. He's going to make my little lot, but I got to go by step, faith by faith, step by faith, step by step, faith, step by step, faith. I got to trust in him step by step, faith. I got to have some step by step, faith. I got to trust in God. Even when it looks like I'm about to run out, God will send somebody my way that will change my situation. Now get this, she will never reap the benefits and the blessings of God if she was not willing to sacrifice the little that she had for the work of God. The Bible says, she said, I'm gathering a couple little sticks, we're going to eat and then we're going to die. And verse 13, Elijah said to her, do not fear. You need to understand what fear will do. Fear will keep you living in the death penalty. I said fear will keep you living in the death penalty. God is trying to give you life, but you are too fearful to take the step. God is trying to lead you on the path of righteousness, but you are too afraid. God is trying to lead you on the path to prosperity, but you are too afraid. afraid, come on, to step out and do something differently. And he spoke to this woman. He says, before I tell you to do these next step, I need you to eliminate fear out of your mind, because if you allow fear to control your mind, you will not hear what the next steps are. Who am I talking to? Some of you are so clouded by fear and your mind is so consumed with fear that you cannot hear the next steps from God. But I come to tell you, you got to forsake fear. You got to say, I will not fear. I have nothing to fear. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for God is with me. God has not given me the spirit of fear, but he has given me the spirit of love and peace and a sound mind. Somebody needs to declare, I have no reason to fear. I have no reason to fear. So he says to her, he says, do not fear. He says, go and do as you have said. But he says, but before you do what you have said, take a little bit of what you got and make me a small cake from it first. And bring it to me. And afterwards, make some for yourself and your son. For thus says the Lord God of Israel, that the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry, until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth. She says, I'm going to cook this meal. I'm taking the last that we have. I got me and my son that I got to provide for. And he says, you can go and make that meal. But before you do, he says, I need a small portion of it. My God, that sounds like time. I just give me a small portion of the little bit that you have, and then you go and you prepare yourself something after you prepared something for me. And he says that if you do that in that order, come on, you prepared a small for me, then you go and prepare yourself. He says that your flour, your bin of flour, will not be used up. And he says, and the jar of oil will not run dry until the word of the Lord comes and the Lord sends rain on the earth. He says, give me that little bit of the little bit that you have. You don't even have to give me all. Just give me a little bit of the little bit that you have. And if you are willing to not be fearful, and if you are willing to give a little bit of the little bit that you have, then I will make sure that that little bit that you have never runs out. I will make sure that that little bit that you have be able to provide for you until this pandemic is over. Come on, until this sickness is over. Come on, until this stay at home is over. If you will just give me a little bit of your time, you only have a little bit, give me a little bit of your time, then I would do some things in that little bit of your time that will transform your life. If you just give me a little, don't sit down and die without giving God a little bit of the little bit that you have. He says that if you give me a little bit of a little bit, I will cause you to live, and you will not run out. You will not run dry. Give me a little bit. So get this. Verse 15 and 16. So she went away and did according to the word of Elijah. And she and he and her household ate many days. My God, my God. The bin of flour was not used up, nor did the jar of oil run dry, according to the word which he spoke by Elijah. So she did according to the word of Elijah. Now the story is changing, because remember, we started out by, in verse 2, God gives Elijah the word. He says, the word of the Lord came to Elijah saying, go away to the brook. Remember that? And the Bible says in verse number 5 that so he went and did according to the word of God. So Elijah heard the word of God, the word, and listened and followed after the word of God. So Elijah was blessed at the brook. When the brook dried up, the word of the Lord came again and told him to go to Zarephath where the widow woman was. And the Bible says that Elijah went and he did what the word of God said. And the widow woman was there. Now, this prophet who had been hearing the word of God, amen, and getting direction, he is now being the voice of God in the life of this widow. While he is hearing the word of God and following the word of God, he is being used by God to speak the word of God. Get this. While he is following the word of God, step-by-step faith, while he is listening to the word of God, adhering to what the directions that God has given him, God is now using him even while he is listening and following after God. God is using him to speak a word to someone else's life. So now she is a recipient of hearing what the word of God is saying. And the Bible says, just as Elijah heard the word of God and he did according to the word of God, the Bible says that this woman, so she went away in verse 15 and did according to the word of Elijah. So now the prophet who is hearing the word of God is now speaking the word of God, and the recipient of that word of God is a woman, a widow woman, who's about to die. You need to understand how essential you are. You are so essential that even while God is working things out for you, he is still using you to speak life to somebody else that's dying. Come on, somebody. You need to understand that I don't care what God, where God has had you. I don't care what situations you are going through. There is still something on the inside of you that God wants to speak to somebody else. He wants to bring life to somebody else's situation. You may not have it all right now. You may be living step-by-step faith. You may not know where your next meal is coming from. You may not know if another check is going to come. You may not know if a deposit is going to come into your bank on this week. But I want you to open up your mouth and do what God has called you to do. I want you to open up your mouth and begin to speak God's word into somebody else's life. And that same God that is providing for you will be that same God that will provide for them. The Bible says that she did according to the word of the prophet Elijah, and she and he, and they ate for many days. My God, somebody need to say, I'm about to eat. Come on. I am about to eat. I am not in lack, but my house is full of everything that God has for me. I am about to eat. I'm about to do what God has called me to do. I shall eat because I heard the word of God and I adhered to his direction. I followed after him. I hastened after his word. I'm about to eat. Things are changing in my home. Who am I talking to in here? Somebody just need to declare things are changing in my home. Come on, come on. If you got the chat fix feature, just put it on and type it out. You need to type it in bold for yourself. Things are changing in my home. I have come and been to announce to your house that things are changing. Come on. I've been called to come and tell you on this morning that circumstances are changing. I come to tell you that God's about to change some things. He's about to turn some things around. And what you thought was lack, God is about to provide more for you. Things are changing in your home. Somebody ought to give God a praise and just say thank you for the change. Because she did according to the word of Elijah. And she and he and the household ate many days. She had enough for one last meal, but she was obedient. She did not fear. Come on. She did not hang on to the little bit of food that she has, but she was willing to sacrifice the little bit that she had for the word of God. Come on. She was willing to hear the word of God and do something different than her original plan. Her original plan was to cook and to die, but God sent the man of God at the right time to speak a word in her life. And not only was she the answer to what God was giving him, but he was the answer to what God wanted to do in her life. So the Bible says that she did according to the word of Elijah, and they ate, and the bin of flour was not used up, nor did the jar of oil run out, according to the word in which he spoke to Elijah. All of this started because Elijah was obedient. He opened up his mouth and he spoke truth to the power. He spoke truth, the truth of God's word that didn't make Ahab the king happy, didn't make Ahab comfortable. But Elijah had no fear. And if you are going to be a man or a woman of God, amen, if you're a citizen of the kingdom, you have to stop operating out of fear and stop worrying about what people think and what people say. And you got to be able to speak only what God has said for you to speak. But now there's a different problem. Because the Bible says now in verse 17 that after these things that the son of the woman who owned the house became sick. So now her son became sick, and his sickness was serious that there was no breath left in him, so he died. She said to Elijah, "What have I to do with you, O man of God? Have you come to bring my sin to remembrance and to kill my son?" And he said to her, "Give me your son." So he took him out of her arms and carried him into the upper room where he was staying and laid on him in his own bed. Then he cried out to the Lord and said, "O Lord, my God, have you also brought tragedy on this widow with whom I lodge by killing her son?" And he stretched himself out to the child three times and cried out to the Lord and said, "O Lord, my God, I pray, let this child's soul come back to him." Then the Lord heard the voice of Elijah, and the soul of the child came back to him, and he revived. And Elijah took the child and brought him down from the upper room into the house and gave him to the mother. And Elijah said, "See, your son lives." Then the woman said to Elijah, "Now by this, I know that you are a man of God, and that the word of the Lord is in your mouth, that is in your mouth is the truth." Now Elijah is at a situation because he's at this woman's house, and now everything is looking good. They have food. They are eating good. Nothing is running out. Life is good. Amen. And have you ever just bounce back from something and life is good? Come on. So before this COVID-19, some of you all were living and were doing things, and business was running. Your job was good. Amen. Your marriage was good. Children was good. Amen. And then this happens, and now it seems like all hell is breaking loose, and it seems like God has now brought judgment on you. Isn't it funny how as believers, amen, we come to Christ and sometimes we have a false narrative of what that life will be like. Sometimes we have a false narrative thinking that that life will be filled with roses, amen, and air freshener, amen. But then we come to find out that things stink, amen, and things sting, amen, and things hurt, even while we're walking with the Lord. And this woman now has embraced life again, amen. She was about to give up on life, but now this promise came into her life, and now she's living, and her son is living, but then her son falls ill, and he dies. He loses his breath. Amen. He has no breath to breathe. And she calls on the prophet. Amen. And she says, "Did you come in my house to really expose my trespasses, to reveal my sins, to bring judgment upon me? And have you come to bring my sin into remembrance and to kill my son?" And the prophet comes and he says, "Give me your son." So the prophet takes that dead boy, and the prophet puts him up in the room and lays him on the bed. And the Bible says that the prophet cries out to the Lord and prays for the son to be resurrected. And he lays upon this child three times. And the Bible says that the son got up. Amen. The son started to breathe. And Elijah took the child and he brought him from the upper room and he gave him to his mom. And he says, see, your son lives. I come to tell somebody that you need to understand how essential you are, because there's somebody dying somewhere that needs life, and that life is in the power of your tongue. Let me say that again. Somebody, God has ordained in your life that is dying. They are dying spiritually. Come on. They are dying emotionally. Come on. And they may even be dying physically. But I want you to understand that you have the power today. You have the power to lay on them, to pray over them, to pray over their lives and say, God, change their situation. Come on. God, restore them. Lift them up. God, take control of their mind again. Come on. Somebody has mentally, come on, is mentally dying. Come on. They are mentally dying. And God is saying that he needs you to open up your mouth and pray the prayer of faith over them and say, God, give them the sound mind in the name of Jesus. God wants to give someone else life through you. Somebody needs to say, I'm essential. I'm essential. I got to watch what I talk about. I got to watch who I hang around. I got to watch the unnecessary conversations that I get. I got to watch what I watch on TV, because I'm too essential to let my life be wasted. I'm too essential to have a whole bunch of negativity in my mind. I'm too essential to be fussing and cussing. I'm too essential to be doing all these things that go against God's will. I am an essential worker, and I got a job to do, and somebody's life is dependent on it. Come on. That husband's life is dependent on you. That wife's life is dependent on you. That child's life is dependent on you. That grandchild's life is dependent on you. You are essential, and you have to know that you are essential. You have to know that you are essential to the kingdom of God. You are essential to the work of God. You are essential to what God is doing in this season. You are essential. And God wants to give life to somebody. He wants to give life to somebody through you. I come to tell you, do not be intimidated by dead things. Do not be intimidated by dead things. Your finances may seem dead because you don't have any income coming in, but I come to tell you, don't let that intimidate you. Your relationship might not be what you want it to be, but I come to tell you, don't be intimidated by that dead situation. Take it to the Lord in prayer. I dare you to start praying. Sometimes God will allow things to die so that you can start opening your mouth and speaking life to it, so that you can know that God is a resurrecting God. Amen. That he can resurrect some dead things. That there are some things that will die in your life, but they are not permanent in the grave. Amen. He wants you to speak some life to it. Amen. And bring life to resurrect it. So the Bible says that he took him and he prayed over him and he laid it and he presented that child and said, your child shall live. Now get this. After all that, the woman says, now I know for sure that you are a man of God. Get this. And that the word of the Lord in your mouth is truth. You need to understand that when you put the word of God in your mouth, it is truth. You are essential. You just haven't tapped into your power yet. You need to tap into your power, the power of the Holy Spirit. Lord, stir up every gift inside of me, because I want my essential gift to be manifested. I want to walk and operate in my essential gift, my call. I want to do what you have called me to do. I want to be who you have called me to be. I want to be in the place that you have called me to. I understand that every place that you have called me to will not be comfortable. That a lot of times the places that you've called me to will not be comfortable. Come on. And somebody, even right now, you aren't comfortable. Amen. There's some pastors that may be watching this right now. You are in the most uncomfortable season of your life, but God says that you are still essential. And what I'm revealing to you is that you won't know how essential you are until you have to lay on top of a child and raise them. Amen. Until you have to go into a widow who's about to give up, and you have to speak truth to her, and you have to speak a word to her, and you have to challenge her to do my will. You won't know how essential you are. See, the church has masked how essential you are. You didn't realize how essential you are, but now you realize how essential you are. Your members didn't recognize how essential it was, amen, to have a pastor, amen. But now they know how essential you are. So you need to understand, as even a member, you are essential to the work, body of God, to the work of God. You are essential. So you have to lift up your head. You can't give up. You can't roll over. You can't throw in the towel. It may be dark, but you won't even recognize the light until you experience some type of darkness, amen? So God is just setting you up and putting you in position because he wants you to know how essential you are. Get this, as an essential worker in the kingdom, he will always take care of you. He will always provide for you. You don't have to worry about tomorrow. You don't have to worry about the next day. You don't have to worry about where your meals are coming from. All you have to do is keep doing the work of God, and God will take care of you. He will provide for you. He will provide for you. There is nothing that he will not do for you. Amen. Because you are an essential worker. You are essential. You are valuable to the kingdom of God. And today I want you to see your value. I don't only want you to see your value, but I want you to recognize the value in others. I want you to stop hoarding and holding on to things that God wants to use to prosper you. I want you to take him at his word. Amen. If God said that he'll do it, then know that he will do it. Amen. If God said that it shall come to pass, then know that it will come to pass. And today I want you to understand how essential you are to this work. You got to get up and you got to do it. You got to get in the game. Come on, you can't throw in the towel. You got to get in the game. There's souls that's dependent on you. There's life that needs to be restored through what you say and through what you do. You got to get up and know that you are essential. Amen. You are valuable. I know others have devalued you. I know that people have overlooked you. Come on. And people have said foul things about you. But I want you to understand, it's not about what others have said about you. It's about what God has said about you and what God is saying about you. And he has good things to say about you. Now get up and do the good work of God. Amen. Go up and do the good work that God has called you to do. What is it that God has called you to do? Get up and do it. Because your provision depended on it and others' provision depended on it. God bless you. God bless you. If you do not know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, amen, that is step number one. You need to invite him into your heart. You need to ask him to be your Savior, amen. And I want you to just, if you believe that, understand that he is not looking for you to change anything. Amen. He will help you change. Amen. He is not looking for you to meet any requirements before you come to him. He just wants you to come. Amen. And confess him as Lord. Believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead. And the Bible declares that you shall be saved. You got to just confess your sins. Repent and be baptized of your sins. Amen. And turn to him. So if you are here today, if you are watching it by any means, and you have not accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, I want you to repeat this prayer after me. And then whatever means you on, whether you're on YouTube, Zoom, Facebook, or wherever, I want you to contact Pastor Marcus D. Beard, Marcus, M-A-R-C-U-S-D, Beard, B-E-A-R-D, at Gmail, or put in the comments that you have given your life to Christ. Give us email, phone number, or some kind of way to contact you, because I want to personally connect with you and just ensure that you have all the knowledge that you need to know what salvation really is. So just repeat after me. Father God, I come to you as a sinner who needs to be saved. I come to you acknowledging that I have sinned. I come to you acknowledging that I have done things that displease you. But Father God, I acknowledge that Jesus Christ, I believe that Jesus Christ came, and I believe that he was bruised for my iniquity. I believe that the chastisement of my peace was upon him. I believe by his stripes, I am healed. And I accept his finished work on Calvary. I accept the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. I accept the fact that he died in my replacement, that he became a substitution for me, that my sins are what really led him to the cross. And I should be dying for my sins, but Jesus Christ paid the price for sin. And now I accept the eternal life. I accept the freedom that comes through Christ. I accept the fact that my sins have been washed away and that Jesus Christ has saved me. I accept the fact that he died for my sins and that he rose and that he ascended to the Father and that he is now interceding for me. And I accept and I look forward for the day where he comes back to present me to himself. I accept your salvation. I turn from my wicked ways. I turn from my sin. I turn from my fleshful acts. And Father God, I ask you to fill me with your spirit. Heal my heart, heal my mind. Set me on the right path. Help me to be who you have called me to be. I thank you for saving me right now. Keep changing me. Keep delivering me. Keep sanctifying me, so that I can produce your glory inside of me. Thank you, so that you can produce your glory inside of me. Thank you, Father God, for accepting me. Thank you for forgiving me for my sins. Thank you for reconciling me into you, back to you. And I thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, I want you to give God a praise. First, amen. For now, welcoming you into the household of the faith, and I want you to give us a way to contact you so that we can get in touch with you and help you grow on this journey, amen, and help disciple you. But you have to understand, now that you have accepted Jesus as your Savior, you are valuable. Old things are passed away. You are not who you used to be. You are not what you used to do. But old things have been passed away, and now all things are new. Welcome into your new journey, and you are essential to the work of God. Amen. I thank you all for logging in. We are going to have Deacon Beard give us a hymn. Amen. And again, if you would like to give to Revelation, you can Cash App Revelation Church. And we thank you all for coming. After Deacon Beard, we will allow some time for some fellowship on Zoom. Amen. God bless you. There you go, Deacon Beard.
I'm good, Lord. He heard my cry. Lord, Lord, he live when trouble rides along.
Thank you for that. Amen. Amen. We want to thank you. We want to thank those of you who came on Facebook. God bless you. We're going to allow everyone to be unmuted. Amen. God bless you. You are all unmuted. You can.
Hello, everybody.
Hello, everybody.
Hello
there.
Hi.
That's safe.
Hi, Sharon.
Hey.
Hi, Evangelist Beard. Dr. Dad, how y'all doing?
Hey. Hey, Sister, I can't see your face, but hey.
I know.
Look, a lot of people ain't showing their faces this morning.
Well, I want to tell everybody that say hi to Mother Liz.
Hi, Mother Liz.
Hi, how you doing?
Okay.
Good.
Good. Hi to everybody.
Everybody all right?
Good.
I do want to welcome our visitor. I know we have Tasha. I'm from Texas.
Hi, Tasha.
Hello.
Hi, Tasha.
Any other guests?
Y'all can't really see me, that's why I know.
You have a beautiful picture.
Any other guests?
Hey, Sister Brown.
If you don't want.
Hey, Sharon.
Jill, you're looking good there, girl.
Hey.